Good evening. My name is Sean Horn. I'm host of The Frame on KPCC. This is a very special group, never before together in a Q&A until now. And I think they're all there. Let's see. Let's bring out Ryan Gosling. Why not? No. Start with Ryan. Emma Stone. Let's do composer Justin Hurwitz. Actor, songwriter, and executive producer John Legend. Cinematographer Nina Sandgren. Costume designer Mary Zofried. I think we have one more seat. Writer, director Damien Chazelle. So seriously, this is the first time you all have been together for a Q&A since making the movie, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like a reunion.
Good, La La reunion. I want to start with a start, and I want to start with the opening number of the movie, which for a long time wasn't the opening number of the movie. I want to, Damien and maybe Emma, you can chime in here too, about where that opening piece was for the first iteration of the film and how it kind of came in and came out and how it finally landed in the movie.
Well, yeah, I mean, the first time I showed Emma a cut of the movie, I think the first number was the number with her and her roommates, her character's roommates, as they're going out to the party. The traffic number wasn't in the movie at all. And we had shot it. It's just that it used to be, there used to be an overture over credits before that, and then you used to see Ryan and Emma in traffic. We used to kind of sink down, see them, then kind of pan off and do the number, and then return to them. So there was this whole kind of engineering around it that, you know, made sense on the page, but didn't really, when faced with it on the screen, felt like three beginnings instead of one. And so we were kind of trying to diagnose the problem, thinking the problem was really the number. And also it's the one number that doesn't really advance story or character. So it's the one number in some sense that was cuttable. But then Emma saw the movie and went, yeah, it felt like not a musical in the beginning. And we kind of realized there was a little bit of a...
Was that your note? Feels like not a musical?
Yeah, I don't think it was just me that made that change possible.
It was all you.
But is that the way in which you work together, that you would see an early cut of the film, Emma, and say, not quite sure how this movie gets going? I mean, what was the process like? And was that reflective of what happened throughout the show?
I think Ryan and I both saw pretty early cuts. I think the first time you saw it, there was a traffic number.
Yeah,
though.
Ryan saw it literally the week after you'd complained. And
you
I put
traffic back
in.
But yeah, we got to see it throughout the process a little bit. I think I saw it maybe four times before it was finished.
So when you put that song at the beginning of the film, it does a couple of things. It establishes the ground rules for the film, and it establishes the way in which the story is going to unfold. Is that important more so in a musical than it is in a narrative film, that you give the audience a primer on what you can and cannot do in the story?
Yeah, I mean, I think the reason for the sort of back and forth at the end of the day was, was that, but it was also that I when writing or conceiving it and when Justin started working on it, you know, about 6 years ago, the idea of opening with a kind of old school overture over kind of painted credits and living with just music for 3 minutes or 2.5 minutes or so, that was, if you'd asked me what the most important things in the movie were, you know, that would be high up there, that was kind of one of the things like the ending or like certain other sequences in the movie that I thought, you know, we'd kind of hang our hat on and felt like part of the ethos of the project. And it just, it wound up in a way, I think, being about choosing between two overtures, because I think that's what we didn't realize, was that the traffic number could actually be an overture, even down to what seems like almost a trivial idea of putting the title La La Land after the number. That was something that came pretty late in editing. My editor Tom Cross and other people, we were all trying to figure out a solution for kind of knowing that we needed the traffic number in, but just something still not working and how to make it work. And it really became about establishing that very overtly as an overture, losing the other overture, having that be this kind of completely clean entree into the world. Then you meet your characters, then the story begins, and we're kind of left with this, you know, memory of what this number represented as the movie goes forward.
I mean, he's describing it incredibly articulately, but Emma and Ryan, when you're having your first conversations with Damien about what this movie is going to be and what its style is going to be and what its tone is going to be, you can read the page and listen to what he has to say, but you probably have significant questions about how he's going to pull it off. When you were first having your conversations with Damien, what were the things that were most important in terms of questions that you wanted to ask him, and what were those conversations chiefly about?
Okay. So, I mean, I met Damien before I read the script, and then talking about the, you know, the, so much of it was kind of solidly tied up in the script, but so many of my questions were about the tone and how this all would work out, which he had a lot of patience for. A lot of questions. And I mean, that was an ongoing conversation, I think, through the whole rehearsal process and shooting it, was how this would all come together to amount to what the script, the promise of the script, because it's one thing to see on screen that we look down the barrel of a camera before Ryan pushes me into space, and it's another to read it on the page and try to conceptualize how we will actually make that happen on the day. But this team, I mean, it was this team. He doesn't want to say anything, but this team.
Ryan had no questions, just like, tell me when my start date is.
No, the thing, there were a lot of references, you know, that we could watch or pull from, but the thing where there wasn't a reference for really was performances, because Damien really wanted these characters to be, you know, not like in a lot of other musicals where the performances are as theatrical as the film, you know. So it was sort of like, how do we find a way to create, you know, what Damien wants, where these performances and these people are relatable and believable, and still have them fly into space and dance among the stars and then come back and continue a conversation. But that was the beauty of, and what was so excited about what Damien was reaching for, was, you know, that seemed like a real challenge, but an exciting challenge.
Justin, I want to talk about your earliest collaborations with Damien. Guy and Madeline on a park bench probably was the seed that grew into this tree. From the beginning of the conversations that you had with Damien about what the color palette or the sound palette was going to be about this film, what were the earliest conversations about melodies and about the sound of the film before you met with Pasek and Paul and started putting lyrics on your music?
Yeah, I remember talking about it. It would be tonally in some way similar to Guy and Madeline, in the sense that it would be grounded and realistic in a lot of places, and then sort of whimsical and romantic in other places. So we were talking about music that could be soaring, that could be lush, that could be romantic, that could be a huge orchestra, as well as smaller and more whimsical in other places. And yeah, we were talking about references, a lot of our favorite musicals and scores and classical music like Tchaikovsky and all sorts of things. But when I was actually composing the melodies, we weren't talking so much about references. We were more just talking about finding melodies that would convey the emotional things that needed to be conveyed in the story. So, you know, the yearning that's in the main theme, me and Sebastian's theme, or the melancholy that's in City of Stars, finding melodies that sort of conveyed those feelings. Those were really what our conversations were about.
And is it just exchanging demos? Is it just, how about this? How about this? How about this? And Damien saying, no, 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 maybe?
Yeah, working many more no's than that before we get to a maybe. But yeah, I just me at the piano for a very long time till I think I have something good. I record it, I send it to him. He usually says no, and then we move on. And I did a little over 1,900 piano demos just at the beginning, just finding.
I'm sorry, I thought you said 1,900.
Yeah, just finding the melodies. Those aren't all different melodies, because we get one we like, and then I go down that road for a while. So, you know, number 29 is like, oh, that one's really good. Let's see where that can go. And where can it unfold? Where can it go? And then, like, many into that iteration, throw it out. Let's move on. So we get to a very high number, but. Once, when I come up with something that's right. Damien knows it immediately. I know it immediately. And it we lock it in and it never changes.
John, you have an interesting order in this film, is that Start a Fire has to be a song that's, well, it kind of has to suck, but it kind of can't suck too much. So I don't know what Damien's exact words were to you when you're thinking about Start a Fire, but what were the exact words? What did you talk about what the song had to accomplish and what it had to reflect in terms of story?
Well, it was interesting to try to thread the needle because he did not want the song to suck. He wanted the song to be a viable alternative for Sebastian. Knowing that Sebastian didn't want to go down that road because stylistically it wasn't what he was aiming for, but he wanted it to be a quality song in that lane, but just not the lane that he wanted to be in. And so that was the goal. And we had to do a few things to like make it clear that that wasn't the path he was supposed to go down. Like, I think even my outfits had to kind of say,
Harry, we'll get you married in a second.
This isn't exactly where Sebastian wanted to be. I think it was the multicolored Lycra jacket that kind of tipped it off. but either way, we had to, in some ways, make it clear that it was not the path that he wanted to go down, but also make it seem like, well, this could be a successful song in its own right, just not the kind of successful song that Sebastian would want to be a part of.
Linus, there are amazing challenges to your camera work in this story. You're doing long takes. You're doing them largely on location, not on a stage, so you can't control the light. And you have to hit marks musically with Justin and Damien's music. And you also have to hit Manny Moore's choreography. How do you put that together on a day? Is it a lot of rehearsal? Are you walking through every day with like iPhones trying to see how it looks before you shoot? How do you map that out?
Well, we worked a lot. We rehearsed a lot, not as much as they rehearsed, but with everything. But we rehearsed a lot, both with iPhones on like on a parking lot, for example, the opening number. We found a location, we had to adjust. And the whole point for the camera was also to be active, like, you know, like a musical instrument or like, actually very much I think like a musical instrument, even though we never talked about it that way, but I think that's what it sort of aimed to be in a way, because we wanted it to be rhythmical with the musical. And so finding all that, we sat every day in prep thinking about shots, and as we found locations, we had to sort of adapt choreography to that with Mandy and with the cast and the dancers. But it was a lot of rehearsals, especially for those numbers. But then we also wanted to include this kind of aesthetics to other scenes as well that wasn't necessarily musical numbers, so that we could travel easier between in you know, not just suddenly jump into a musical from reality, but actually always sort of live in that same heightened reality with a real acting.
So Emma and Ryan, when you are having to do, I mean, you've got to hit your marks, obviously. The music has got to be at a certain place where Linus's cameras are at a certain place. Working with Damien, how do you still find room that you're not so technically focused on where and how you have to be, that there's still some spontaneity, they still get performance? Do you do a lot of that in rehearsal? And what was it like during actually filming to make sure that you still have spontaneity when you're worried about so many other technical things that you have to do?
One thing we did with Damien a lot in the pre-production process was we would improvise scenes, and he would, sit and curate what he liked about the improvisations and then write them into the script. So when we were on there on the day, they were things that had come natural to us at one point, but that they had been sort of, you know, we knew what they were in the moment. And, because things were being shot in one long take, in a lot of cases, the challenge became, finding the musicality in the scenes. So to keep a percussive nature to the way that we were talking, so it felt spontaneous and improvised, but at the same time, it had a musicality that would support and glue the musical sequences together. And it was fun in a way. It was like working like musicians. Damien's a drummer, and so he kind of encouraged like that, you know, it even came down to, in some cases, like shaving a few seconds off of this beat or that beat, you know, because, you know, he had the, you know, the whole, you know, the rhythm of the whole piece in his head. And so he knew what the rhythm of that moment needed to be. Does that help?
I think that's a good answer. Emma, do you have anything to add to it?
That was a pretty solid answer.
Okay.
But I think, yeah, it was very rare that Damien got so percussive that that it was like you were actually playing a song. I mean, we would move within these sort of confines and try to be as spontaneous and free within them. But I do remember, I don't know whether it was an ADR or whether it was on the day, but there was one time where Damien did say to me, or maybe twice, that he said to me, and the line's going to go, da-da-da-da-da-da. Like, but with the words, yeah. No, it was. I remember when it was. It was. He'll figure it out. Like he'll figure it out and it'll work. How's dad? Like da 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 da. Papa. And I was like, all right. Well, there we go. Am I rushing or dragging? Am I rushing or dragging?
I apologize.
And now we know where that character in Whiplash comes from. Okay. Mary, kind of banking on this kind of heightened reality idea that we're talking about in terms of what the musical gives you, me and Sebastian also live in the real world. And as characters, they may know they're in a musical, but they're also walking on real streets. They're out in the world. So what does that mean to you as a designer in terms of creating something that both seems larger than life, but it's grounded in a reality where these characters don't seem like they're characters in their own story?
Yeah, that was the challenge of the film, was to try to make it so it's beautiful and romantic, and to also have it be real. So there's just choices that we made, and it was through palette and through silhouette and through fabric choices, like never going too fancy or not too embellished, and keeping things sort of monochromatic and not busy, like just make it a powerful statement with a single color as opposed to multicolors and prints. And does that make sense?
It does. Yeah. It does.
And
outside of John's band, yeah. What about his outfit?
And there was also discussion about the very early on we met, and we talked about the arc of the film, and sort of it was almost like a graph that you drew. Do you remember that, Damien? And yeah, that it peaked at the planetarium, and that's where the apex of like saturation and color and romance happened. And then it was a denouement, and there was a desaturation of color, and that was intentional. And literally, like Mia's in black and white at her one woman show, and Ryan ends up Sebastian's wearing all black, and he's becoming monochromatic, and he's surrounded by this cacophony of color that you rock so well. And
you brought from home, right, John?
Yeah, that was my personal wardrobe.
John,
the orange straw.
It's what I wear to the grocery store.
Yeah,
he came to his fitting, and you were so sweet about where, like, and we didn't introduce that pink jacket until the very end. Like, I kept it on the outside of the fitting room, and I was like, and then there's a progression that happens, and then I brought that thing in, and he was like, okay, like you were down with it, but I was. I didn't open the fitting with that. I didn't work backwards. We started from the very beginning. Anyway, so there was, but you tried to, I mean, I always tried to legitimize how Mia could pay for this dress and where did this dress come from. And Sebastian, like, yes, like to me, he's one of those characters that he would rather have quality, not quantity. I'll have one or two good sport coats, and you can wear them for a long time if they're cut well and made well, and he takes care of his stuff, and he takes care of his clothes, and he doesn't have a million things. Like, he had two trousers and five shirts and two sport coats and a suit. Like, it wasn't a lot of clothing. It was just, you know, just chosen well, and I think that that's...
You're feeling very self-conscious about my sport coat right now.
Yeah, you could use some more texture. No, I'm just kidding. But it's a, you know, that's how I approached it. And for Mia, like, I wanted it to be believable. Like, she could have found that in a H&M, or she could have found, but I also wanted it to be beautiful on her, and I couldn't find it in an H&M, but I didn't want to overdo it. That's what I meant by choosing fabrics that were not too, that just had the right, you know, balance of reality and fantasy.
We were, Tom Cross, your editor, is not here, but I'm curious, Damien, in terms of what you had to solve in post and what you had to solve in editing, what were the biggest challenges and how did you go about solving them? And were there things that you, where you finished principal photography, where you really weren't sure how things were going to land, like the opening sequence, that you were able to solve in editorial?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was, I mean, one slightly... I remember kind of at the very beginning of just sort of towards the end of shoot as we were passing stuff off to Tom, you know, he'd be getting all these long take, you know, very long take sequences. And he and I had done, you know, not that long before, I'd done Whiplash together, which was sort of the opposite. It was all very splintered and we had very little time to edit Whiplash. So he was getting this footage in and I think he and I were both thinking, well, this will be very easy. You just lop off the slates and you kind of have the movie. And lo and behold, you know, we wound up spending almost a year in editing. But what it came down to, it was not kind of dealing with a quantity of coverage or sort of, you know, a quantity of cuts the way it was in Whiplash. It was much more, I guess, hard to describe stuff. It was tone. It was overall pacing, not just within scenes, but within the whole movie. It was definitely the kind of balance that everyone has talked about between realism and fantasy. Because at first, when we first kind of just put the movie together, the way it seemed like it would be put together and following the sort of graph of, you know, the emotional arc that we felt the movie should follow, yeah, certain things were just not, it still felt off kilter. It felt, you know, too fantastical in places where it needed to feel realistic, too realistic in places, you know, and so that I think is where a lot of the searching came from, a lot of the shaving or rearranging of scenes or even just, you know, co-opting scenes for other things. I mean, there was just a lot of stuff that I wouldn't have foreseen, obviously, that kind of became the brunt of our work during post. But we were also lucky to have, you know, I mean, Justin, obviously, who'd written so much music for us to film to beforehand as needed to happen, not just the numbers, but certain sequences like Emma running to the movie theater, things like that. We were blasting score on set. So that stuff kind of slid into the movie. But then everything else, Justin was able to sit there literally by our side during the entirety of editing, composing cues for underscore. Every time we'd finish a scene, we'd pass it off to him and he'd bring it back to us, you know, the day, you know, the next day or sometimes even less time with, you know, a draft of a cue. And, you know, we'd kind of give him notes and go back. And so it was this sort of very fluid system where there was no temp score. There was no kind of, well, when do we kind of bring in this other element? We also had the sound team working with us during a lot of that time. So everyone was kind of immediately early on embedded, which I think helped, you know, it just helped kind of grease the wheels and get the whole thing moving at least in the right direction, even though there was a lot of searching within that.
This is obviously a movie that is a love letter to jazz, a love letter to the movie musical. It's a love story itself, but for the actors and for the film, it's also a love letter about Los Angeles in terms of the way the city itself is cast, the locations you use, the way in which the city is part of the story. And I guess my question is for Ryan and Emma and John as actors in the film, did the making of this movie change the way you saw the city and change your relationship to Los Angeles as you're thinking about it and making La La Land?
Well,
you guys should just tap each other.
I know,
there like the mysterious
looks.
Like a
Carol Burnett little system. I think Damien has said there were over 70 locations. Is that right? Yeah. So we were all over the city. We went all the way down to Watts Towers. There was this beautiful moment on Angel's Flight, which is shut down in downtown Los Angeles. And I think that the thing that I loved most about the experience of the movie, and this is also kind of hijacking a Damien quote, is that they took these incredible real locations and they made them look fake. I mean, David and Sandy Wasco made, the production designed it in a way that just looked, you know, there was like a fire hydrant and a light post and there were these beautiful flowers all over everything. And all of a sudden you saw LA in this way that you always kind of dreamt that you would see it. And then Linus was shooting it and you would look through the, you know, look at the monitor and it was just this insanely beautiful, magical version of the city. So I definitely saw LA in a different way through that, you know, through that lens. And I'm also so grateful in watching the film to be able to see it that way forever in a way that's lasting because I've never really seen it look quite like that. But I appreciate that it can.
It can. John?
Yeah, I feel a similar way. I've only lived here full time for about a year now. And I normally was a New Yorker for most of my adult life. And so I look at the film and I'm like, wow, there's all these things I have never done in Los Angeles. I got to go to the planetarium. I got to do all these things. Maybe I can dance like them too. And, you know, I just, I feel like it is a love letter to the city. And it's also like, it's kind of a, it's almost like a guide to how to make the most of the city. And I think sometimes we get in our rut of like just the things we do normally for work and all these other things. And, you know, my wife and I don't go and do a lot of these things. And I'm like, wow, we should do more of these things. And let's be like me and Sebastian.
Ryan, anything?
Yeah, I think LA is that beautiful, but it's fleeting. And it's for like 10 minutes a day if you're in the right spot at the right time. And suddenly you just see how magical it is. And what's so exciting about this film is that Linus and Damien were trying to capture those moments and you know, kind of honor them in a way, and then assemble them together in this one in one place. You know, it felt like you know, they were like you know, in Planet Earth or something, when the guys wait in the tree and they wait for the bird to come out of the nest. You know, and it's just for that one moment that, you know, that's so magical. But it takes so much planning and patience, you know, to create to catch it at that time. But also there's this, they added this extra little, I remember seeing the camera tests, and there was like a wet down outside the studio, and they had just were testing film stocks or something. But Damien had goosed it with this pink light. And so the sky was purple and pink, and it was just a water truck. And yet there was this like beautiful pink light coming from the side. It's like the most beautiful water truck you've ever seen. And I just felt like so relieved from watching the camera test. I thought, okay, this, if they can make a water truck look like that, this is, we're in good hands.
Damien, I'm going to save the last question for you. This was obviously not an easy movie to get made. You and Justin have been thinking about it and working on it for how many years now?
Six. The thing, because we talked about in 2010, we started in 2011, I think.
But percolating probably longer than that. You've made it. You have some amazing awards recognition. People are going to see the movie. Critics are liking it. But in terms of what it means to you, in terms of what you take away from the satisfaction of making the movie, what has been the most gratifying thing to you personally of making this movie and sharing it with audiences?
That's great. That's I have to like come up with a good answer. I mean, I think, you know, it's when you were saying that, you know, talking about the time spent making it. I mean, one thing I think that I learned a lot, and maybe it's the thing that I'm the happiest about with the movie, is just that there were so many instances on the journey of making this movie where it, you know, fell apart, or where, you know, we'd be told that, you know, it would never happen, you know, you know, someone would ask Justin, who, you know, our dream of who would be in the movie would be, and he'd say, oh, well, you know, Emma, Ryan, it'd be kind of cool. And they would just look at him like, I think the exact quote was,
good luck with that.
That person will remain nameless.
It was me, like, and Emma, actually.
Yes. It was us.
It was John, actually.
It was you. It was Emma.
It was John Legend.
It was Keith. He's always squashing people's dreams.
But also moments where I kind of felt like, oh, geez, things are not going the way we need them to go. And now I look back and I realize that actually there were many cases where, in a weird way, we or the movie were saved from ourselves. You know, that you know, moments where we wanted to make it earlier, we weren't actually ready to make it, you know, or moments where it would have been made under different circumstances, it wasn't quite the right version of that movie, and it was worth waiting. And so it just kind of, you know, at least I've tried to learn from it, to have a little bit of faith in the kind of twists and turns that, you know, a career or life or your art or whatever can take, and that the things that seem like a disaster at the moment can actually be exactly the things that are going to, and in a weird way, of course, it's sort of in a meta way that we only kind of realize now having made the movie, it's kind of in many ways what happens during parts of the movie. You know, it's the one woman show that no one shows up to, but actually winds up being you know, it's stuff like that where I kind of, even if it was stuff I'd written about before, this whole journey of making it kind of helped me actually internalize and learn that for real. And to have a little bit of, a little bit more hope, I guess, in that, you know, in that frame of mind, and it's certainly something I'm kind of thinking of right now at a time when, you know, given lots of things in the world, I don't have a lot of hope. So it's you know, just trying to kind of hold on to that sort of sense that of these twists and turns and of the things you can learn from moments that seem like not great moments, just having that kind of holding on to that kind of hope and knowing that the dream can keep guiding you. Again, it seems sort of cliched, but it is genuinely something that I kind of take away from the process of making it.
I think we do too as an audience. Thank you, Damien. I want to thank Ryan, Emma, Justin, John, Linus, Mary, Damien. Thank you guys for coming out.
Thank you.
And thank you guys for joining us.